Kia ora iti, we welcome back to Q&A. Around the world, health systems have been overwhelmed by COVID-19 outbreaks, with intensive care departments bearing the brunt. So is New Zealand's ICU system in a fit state to handle this outbreak? Dr Craig Carr is the Regional Chair for the Australian and New Zealand Intensive Care Society. Tēnā koe, thanks for being with us, Dr Carr. What is the likelihood of a spike of ICU patients in the coming weeks?
Kia ora, Jack. The ICU community have studied how COVID works around the world, and in non-vaccinated patients, for every 100 patients in the community who become infected with COVID, we expect between 10 and 14 admissions to hospital. And of those, 2 to 4 would come to the intensive care unit and the rest would go to the wards. So as we see numbers in unvaccinated patients rise, we anticipate that there will be some patients who work their way through hospital admission and ward admission.
Are you ready for it?
The intensive care community in New Zealand is an incredibly dedicated team of professionals, and we have some wonderful expert nurses and doctors who amongst them have given care for many years that we know through evidence results in the best outcomes for intensive care in the world. And so in as much as we can be, we have prepared for this. We have been rehearsing over the last year, following information, but the reality is the best possible thing we can do is to minimise the demand on the healthcare service and minimise the spread of this lethal virus to the public. And that's done by following the guidance that has been given by the public health officials. So level 4 lockdown to absolutely minimise transmission is essential. And then all the other rules about hand hygiene, social distancing, wearing your mask, as Minister Hipkins already alluded to, you know, this is more infectious than previous strains, and therefore it's all the more important that we are absolutely fastidious in observing these things. And if we do have to go out for essential things only, use your COVID tracer app.
What did you make of the Minister's comments regarding intensive care capacity in New Zealand?
I think it's fair to say that it's been spoken of widely. The capacity of intensive care in New Zealand compared with comparative countries in the OECD is relatively low. So for instance, we've between 2 and 3 times, Australia has between 2 and 3 times more intensive care beds than we have. In the last year, there has been some additional funding to open a few more intensive care beds. But again, as the Minister alluded to, the challenge there is that the bed requires expert staff to care for the patient, and to keep one intensive care bed open for a whole year, 24 hours a day, requires 5 to 6 expert-trained intensive care nurses. Now, it takes 4 to 5 years to train an expert intensive care nurse to become a senior intensive care nurse. It takes 5 to 7 years to train a doctor to become a senior intensive care doctor. So you can't radically increase the number of staff you have overnight. That has to be part of a sustained long-term strategy. The ICU community is working very hard in partnership with the ministry to develop such a strategy over the next 15 years. And we hope to see the investment and resource grow over that period. But in the short term, it is a real challenge, because not only do you have to recruit new nurses if you're opening new beds, but you also have to replace the attrition of nurses who are leaving just through retirement, or they might be emigrating back to their own country, or they might have chosen a different career pathway. And so it really is, especially in these times of closed borders, it's a real challenge to open more beds.
So to be absolutely 100% clear, with the ventilator, the monitor, the staff and the bed itself, has New Zealand's ICU capacity increased since the start of the pandemic?
To get that answer precisely, you would have to speak to every DHB individually. But it is my understanding that there has been very little change indeed in the last year. We have received funding to open more beds, but we've been unable to recruit the staff to operationalise them.
What would it take in terms of an outbreak for New Zealand's intensive care departments to be overwhelmed?
I think we've all watched the television programmes and seen images from countries where services have become overwhelmed. Some of those services are less well resourced than New Zealand, such as India, and some are better resourced than New Zealand, such as Italy. And I think the best way of looking at that is, what do we have to do to avoid getting into those situations? And that comes back to the public health advice. You know, observe the level four lockdown absolutely fastidiously, stop transmission, stamp out the virus, and as soon as you are eligible, get vaccinated. I have a friend in the United Kingdom that I speak to quite regularly, and I think it came from social media there. They have a little aphorism, a truism, that is, one dose of vaccine saves your life, two doses of vaccine saves you from requiring admission to hospital. Now, I've checked that with friends and colleagues who work in intensive care in Australia and New Zealand, and they say that pretty much that's true. If you have a single dose of vaccine, it will probably save your life. If you have two, it just reduces the stress on the health system.
Could anything more have been done since the start of the pandemic to increase our ICU capacity?
It's a difficult question to answer. We have worked very hard and collegially with one another as a community, with the Ministry of Health. We have secured more equipment. So we have secured enough equipment to open potentially, albeit incredibly transiently and with great stress upon the system, we could expand potentially up to 500 beds with life support kit. But a surge capacity bed is not the same as a business as usual intensive care bed, because in a surge capacity bed, you have part of your care provided by experts, which is their normal day job, and part of your care will be provided by very dedicated, caring and loving healthcare professionals, but for whom it is not part of their normal day job. Mm. And we know from overseas that as soon as we start to flex into surge capacity in our hospitals, we start to see poorer outcomes. It is better to have the surge capacity than not to have it. It is better not to need it than to have to use it. And so again, I come back to everyone, please, please, please be vaccinated and observe the lockdown.
You talked a little bit about attrition for staff working in ICUs. Yeah. Has that been an issue in the last 18 months? Have you had problems keeping nurses and staff in New Zealand?
Yes, we have had several challenges. One of them is just the standard retirement and resignation. People going to work elsewhere because their spouse works elsewhere. We've also had challenges getting new people in from overseas and recruitment. And partly you don't want to denude other health systems of their vital staff. But of course, there are barriers that you have to cross, quite rightly. You have to know that the people coming to work in your system are sufficiently well trained and expert to work there. So it's been a difficult time for everyone. I think there is a piece of work going on, I believe, at the moment to see what else we can possibly do to facilitate easier extension of work visas. Is there anything we can do to make seamless things like MIQ? If we've got healthcare workers that might be interested in coming, how can we make the whole process more seamless? But I'm only aware of these vaguely in my capacity of an ICU practitioner. We'd be much better to speak to the ministers of immigration, health, the New Zealand Nursing Council, to understand that in more depth.
Several hospitals have been affected by this Delta strain outbreak so far. How much of a concern is that to you?
Any person, whether a member of the public or a patient, exposed to Delta variant COVID, it's clearly a huge concern because it's a very dangerous disease in anyone that's exposed to it. In hospitals, the risk will be slightly higher because patients already have other illnesses that can increase their risk and susceptibility, such as hypertension, diabetes. And equally, if staff catch this, they may have to be isolated and go away from work. So we denude our healthcare system of nurses when we most need them. The other side of that story, of course, is that healthcare workers and frontline workers have been vaccinated already. So they have slightly higher protection afforded to them. And many of the patients who would be susceptible, such as those with hypertension, patients over 65, they have also been prioritised for vaccination. So there is a concern there, but we'd have to watch how things map out to see what's going to happen.
Kia ora, Craig. We really appreciate your time. You stay safe. That's Dr. Craig Carr, who is the New Zealand Chair of the Australian New Zealand Intensive Care Society.